Good morning, everyone. On behalf of the Asian American Research Institute, we welcome you to this conference. I have the honor of introducing to you the next speaker, Professor Marianne Fass, the Director of Research, Brookdale Center on Aging, Urban Public Health, Hunter College. The topic of presentation is healthy aging among the elderly Asian American. Can we meet the challenge? Please welcome Maria Fass.
Thank you so much. It's a pleasure to be here. I've got a fair number of slides, which I'm going to go through fairly quickly, and we can have questions afterwards. We'll be broaching this subject from both a research and policy perspective, because I think the two must inform each other to create better service. So let me start with the scene we face in U.S. as a whole, this huge increase in elderly that we're at the brink of, this demographic tsunami, as some people have said. And just for the latest statistics, just in the last year, the group of over 65 has grown over 350,000 people. We're now at 36.3 million, and that's set to take off over the next few years as we face the aging explosion of our 20 coming from the baby boom, as Commissioner Mendez Santiago mentioned. So that by 2050, we're going to have 87 million, more than double than the current population. Here you can see those figures graphically. And to get a sense of how Asian elderly fit into this national scene, you can see the Asian profile here, which is the light green, getting wider and wider as we move into the 21st century. And so the proportion of Asian elderly among our elderly is growing. And this is the first time I actually saw this issue of immigration and aging being taken up by the press. So it's just becoming into media attention. And this was not that long ago, as you see, only a few weeks ago, in an op-ed piece in the Washington Post. And what all this means, of course, is as our aging population is going to be becoming increasingly and increasingly diverse. So now, Asian Americans, which you've heard, constitute 1/4 of the nation's total foreign-born population, and 8% are 65 years and over, we're going to see a 213% increase over the next 50 years in the population of people who identify themselves as Asian. The portion of elderly who are Asian today, it will increase from 2.3% all the way to 8% in 2050. But Asian, we've been saying Asian all morning. What in the world does Asian really mean? I went to the Census Bureau to see how it's defined. And when we say Asian, this is what we're talking about: very diverse groups of people. And that's not all. We're talking about also Pacific Islanders, another very diverse group of people. Tongans are not like Fijians. They're not like Native Hawaiians. So for us to talk about serving the Asian community, I think the first thing we have to be aware of and be very careful about and sensitive to is the vast diversity within the Asian community. And talking only about Asians as a sort of a general average can lead to what I think is the Asian fallacy. And I'll give you an example of that. I mean, we get wrong statistics and wrong measures of indicators of risk. For instance, a large study we're doing at Brookdale right now on it's an effectiveness evaluation of of a smoking intervention, culturally competent, culturally sensitive, working with a number of partners, Asian American partners in Flushing and Sunset Park here in New York City. This was started in collaboration with the New York City Department of Health and Mental Hygiene. And this was started 5-6 years ago now, before we had any good data on what were smoking rates among Chinese Americans. We were focusing on Chinese Americans in our particular study. And that's the largest group, as you know, in New York City, with over 400,000. Kind of at a census, and some people say it's twice that many in reality. But when we started this, the only data we had on smoking rates among Asians looked like this. This is put out by CDC, and it continues. So Asians on this chart look like they have a very low smoking rates. Well, that's dangerous, really, because then they say, well, we don't really need services. But when we went into the Chinese community and actually did a household-based survey, we found a 50% higher rate of smoking among Chinese American men than the general population. Chinese American women have a very low rate, so the average, even there, an average is misleading. So what is needed is a transcultural gerontology, and we are just beginning to think about this in the level of depth and specificity that we need to think about it here in New York and in the United States. Our commissioner gave us the inspiration of thinking about successful aging that comes from definitions from Jack Rowe. He used to be president of Mount Sinai Medical Center here, or productive aging, which comes from definitions from Bob Butler, who began the National Institute of Aging and then developed the first department of geriatrics at Mount Sinai Medical Center. But there are many, many influences on being able to have this outcome of successful or productive aging. And we have to take into account the larger context. I mean, it's very important to keep the contextual framework very much in mind, all the way from the larger environmental influences, all the way through social community influences and living conditions, as well as healthcare access. They're all part of what's influencing successful aging, and we really need to develop better research, better models, and better service models that encompass this broader understanding of what is contributing to successful aging. We've heard a lot about the Asian American Elders in New York City report. Here's a picture of it. I commend that report. I think it's a wonderful report, spearheaded by our founding executive director of Brookdale Center on Aging, Rose Dobroff, in collaboration with Asian partners. And that is it provides some groundwork to build a positive approach to increasing successful aging in our city. Now, we in this room probably all agree on that. However, the overriding political context that we're in, we can't ignore. And that is really looking at aging not as an opportunity, but as a crisis. And we're hearing that a lot in the media. And that crisis really is coming through this background noise of ageism, really, which is a stereotyping elderly as non-productive and worrying about dependency ratios and concerns that there's going to be financial collapse. This word crisis, invokes. Talk about both a physical and political crisis. The crisis of Social Security is one. We saw that being raised last year, and that this crisis mentality that is a political connotations really is just that. It's a political presentation, but what are the real facts? Is it really a crisis? And what is the word crisis doing in terms of creating a political context? I learn all my economics these days from Paul Krugman, his column in the New York Times. He's one of the best economic thinkers and writers these days. But this word crisis is essentially part of a larger plan, the current political plan, of really undermining the legacy of Franklin Roosevelt. The crisis in Social Security was really trying to move that security program out of the public welfare system. This word crisis and that kind of political context comes from what I call economic myths of aging. And I think there are four large myths that continue to drive our policy context, which then affects our ability to do funded research and service provision. So I wanted to address these myths one by one quickly and debunk them. First, preventive care is not cost effective. Well, that's completely wrong. That was believed up until 20 years ago or so, and some of the first studies, I was lucky enough to be involved in some of those, which showed that actually preventive medicine among 65 and older is very cost effective. And those findings continue only to become more and more clear as the elderly in general are undergoing what's called a compression of morbidity, in the sense that that disability rates really are decreasing over among our nation's elderly. There are so many cost-effective programs, and I will come back to this theme towards the end of my talk, that cost-effectiveness is a policy approach that combines service and research towards political and advocacy that can actually affect legislation. And when we did the cervical cancer screening, which was the first time this was done among elderly women, and found that it was not only cost effective but cost saving when we look at low income elderly women, this very small study done on Lotus 1-2-3 spreadsheets 20 years ago, now at least you use Excel, but we've got a little bit more sophisticated our methods as well, but really a small study done really with a colleague and myself over the Christmas vacation. It was new, got into the Journal of American Medical Association, and ended up through congressional attention and another study that replicated it when we did a national model, ended up influencing Congress to pass the first preventive benefit funded by Medicare in this country. We started from seeing a small program that was successful right here in New York City at Elmer's Hospital among low-income women immigrants. These women and their research and service partners, I worked with a physician that was working with them. Together, we put together an effort that has ended up helping influence national policy. This is a model we need to continue, and I'll come back to it later. The myth number two, the elderly are drained on the healthcare system. Well, what's the reality there? The healthcare system is one of the most productive systems in this country. In New York City, it's the third largest industry. And in fact, there was a very interesting study done by the Conservative Federal Reserve Bank that showed that who got us out of our latest, out of our biggest, most recent recession is the healthcare industry. So as to the extent that that elderly, yes, do use more health services, in any other industry would be considered a boon. If we were buying more cars, the auto industry would love it. But we say, we're using more healthcare. Well, we should be excited about that. It's a great industry, and it's a very important part of the economies of not only New York, but many of our major cities, including Boston and Houston. and LA. And another myth, really, is that we can't continue to spend more and more on healthcare. That's absolutely untrue. There's some very good work coming out of Harvard now, David Cutler and others, that are showing we can continue to spend, increase our spending on healthcare without hurting spending on any other services for a great deal of time. The myth number three, the elderly are drain on the economy. Well, that's a myth as well. There's absolutely nothing in economic theory that says that there has to be economic decline associated with an aging population. And in fact, the data seem to show the opposite. I predict that as the boomers move into this aging group, there's going to be a huge economic stimulus. There's a huge amount of demand. There's a lot of income these boomers carry with them. I think it's going to, we may have a new technological explosion. So there's nothing to say that this is going to hold the economy back. It could actually stimulate the economy. Myth number four, increased longevity will cause increased health costs. Well, the reality that costs per last year of life are holding constant, they're not getting bigger. That it's actually a trivial increase in Medicare and total Medicare and total nursing home costs when you look at it over time. And in reality, again, the research, again out of Harvard, this is now by Professor David Bloom, another professor of economics, economists have studied for a long time that income does affect health. They're now turning around and showing that health does affect income as well. And in developing countries, we see an increase in 10-year gain in life expectancy adds a full million, a percentage point to annual income growth. When you're thinking 3 to 4%, that's a huge percentage increase in annual income growth with longevity increases. There's no reason that developed countries can't also follow those patterns. And so as we approach our aging boom, I think we've got a number of opportunities ahead of us to work as partners to develop research and service that can, here in New York, provide models, not only for other New Yorkers, other neighborhoods than the ones we're working in, but across the nation. And as we do this, we need a lot of hard work and forward thinking, collaborative spirit and some innovation, and good, solid research methods. But first, how to do it correctly and in a way that's going to be really meaningful, we need to think through a conceptual framework and have a conceptual model that guides us. There's absolutely no theory right now in the field of immigrant aging, successful aging, urban aging. It's a very exciting field that is just beginning. We're starting to think in terms of these contextual ways of multi-level, developing multi-level models that that include neighborhood effects as well as individual effects, as well as obviously family and social support effects, on creating opportunities at the neighborhood level for productive and successful aging. But what do we need to think through as we develop these models? We need to keep in mind a number of different issues, including some of the issues that are surrounding myths concerning immigrants, the healthy migrant effect, access is an extremely important issue, like you mentioned earlier, and environmental, occupational, and the stereotype in particular that affects Asian immigrants, Asian minorities, of the model minority, which is really, there are high levels of education among Asian immigrants, and in general, there's a high level of assimilation, and they have been termed a model minority, but basically, what that does is trivialize all the social and health and mental health problems among Asian populations. and reduce services, reduce attention, reduce policy, even responsibility. I don't think we have that in our commissioner here in New York, who understands the much more complex. But this is something we do need to keep in mind. There's obviously tremendous complexity of factors that affect health in the community. And I don't have to tell social workers that. But may have to tell researchers that. We need to develop better research models that include this complexity. Here in New York, we find very large variation in life expectancy by neighborhood. So disparities, as our commissioner said, are extremely important to address in New York, and that really should be our goal in the next 20 years, is to reduce these disparities in life expectancy. Now, how do we do that? Well, there's a very good article recently published in the Journal of Urban Health by one of our own New Yorkers, who is actually the editor of the American Journal of Public Health, Mary Northridge, and a sister professor at Columbia University. And I'm taking her model of how to start thinking through community-based, neighborhood-based models to improve healthy aging. So that we don't put the emphasis only on the individual, only on the family, but on a larger policy and social context of improving neighborhoods and political atmospheres and environmental atmospheres that will allow and support productive and successful aging. Among Asian immigrants in these sort of fundamental contexts of forces that are affecting at the larger environmental level. I mean, one thing that's very important is to keep in mind is history of human rights doctrines and where they come from, the stress that could be evolved from human rights abuses. All other specific culturally complex and contextual factors that immigrants face in merging cultures and environments. Intermediate factors, I think we're going to hear soon from Professor Cynthia Chen on transportation, a well-known expert here at CUNY. But many other, the built environment is now becoming a very important research topic, and how can we make the built environment support healthy aging? A number of different possibilities there, including, of course, transportation and better, safer sidewalks, public parks, some of the things that, again, our commissioner was addressing. Then what Dr. Northridge calls proximate influences, and here we have sort of the more traditional things that we think about when we do gerontology research, the health behaviors, social integration, social support, stressors, buffers, again, that can be part of the cultural setting or political setting, contextual setting of the city. And then finally, our outcomes of successful aging, what we're aiming for, well-being positive health outcomes. So that's just living through a very complex way of thinking about how research really should address how do we take into account and model all these factors that influence healthy aging. So obviously, Asian aging research development has to be multidisciplinary. And in fact, what we're developing here at CUNY under the leadership of Professor Nick Freuden, distinguished Professor Nick Freudenberg of Hunter, who is a professor of urban public health, who has a grant from National Institutes of Health to develop transdisciplinary curriculum in urban public health. And we at Brookdale are growing from that base to develop a model of healthy urban aging, which really doesn't exist yet in the literature. There's beginning work, some by Kawachi out of Harvard, looking at neighborhood-based effects on health. But this is where the field is going. and obviously needs very strong partnerships with community-based organizations and social workers to develop the field in a way that is really applicable and relevant. It's a multi-level development that's needed. We bring into the mix a lot of different skills, epidemiology, economics, in addition to the gerontology and the social sciences that inform gerontology. Just a few things that we've been up to. The healthy migrant hypothesis was something that we were interested in seeing. Did that really play out in New York City? What does that mean? And we looked at, we did a GIS, a geographic information system, doing a neighborhood-based analysis of hospitalization rates and looking at the neighborhoods by the proportion of foreign-born within those neighborhoods. Now, another issue in American culture and politics right now is this myth that immigrants are costing society. And actually, you know, that's very controversial. And the work out of the Urban Institute shows clearly that it's an economic benefit, it exceeds the economic costs. But what we're finding here very, very quickly in New York City, you see Jackson Heights, you're pointing out there. Well, it's hard to read, but the small little pie is actually showing the pink is number of foreign born. So you see that's got a very large proportion, almost 75% looks like, are foreign born. And the white color is the lowest hospitalization rate. And that's what we found. That's the correlation. The more the foreign-born proportion, the lower the hospitalization rate. So actually, if foreign-born had the same rates as US-born, we would be spending so much more, in fact, in hospitalization costs in New York City. In fact, we're saving about $500,000. Among foreign-born elderly every year in terms of lower hospital costs than U.S.-born. Now, is that a good thing or a bad thing? Is that reflect a healthy migrant hypothesis, which is, you have to be very healthy to leave your home country and come to a new country and set up a whole new life? Or is it lack of access? And so that's where we are in our research. We don't know that needs to be known and understood, and if it's lack of access, which I suspect is probably at least in some cases, it's very important to address that. But at least the one thing we say is immigrants are not costing us, certainly more than the native born populations in hospital costs in New York City. Nationally, there's no reason why it looks like over time immigrants should not have the same health issues as Americans, and how can we reverse that process and have native-born learn better from some of the healthy behaviors that immigrants bring with them. I think one of the best things that happened in New York City in the past 20 years was the Korean markets and Chinese restaurants. I mean, it really, the Indian restaurants, all our big restaurants, all our ethnic restaurants really improved, I think, the health of the diet in New York City. But as you can see, this is work done at the National Center of Health Statistics. It shows over a 15-year period that the relative risk for these risk factors, smoking, obesity, and hypertension, doubles in within 15 years among immigrants. Our commissioner mentioned just what was in the lead article in the New York Times, hepatitis risk for East Asians in New York, which the article was a little bit sensationalist. It was kind of saying 24% for quite a while, but that was, they finally at the end said, correcting for a number of different biases. This was not a random sample. It didn't seem like it was more like 15%. But that's a risk factor that's just becoming known, and we need to address it. In terms of occupational risks, well, the traditional, there are a number of occupational risks, and it's well known that immigrants and people of color in the U.S. have much lower rates of filing with workers' comp to address occupational-related injuries. And it's a terrible consequence here in New York City. We did a small study with funded by the Robert Wood Johnson Foundation that, again, looked at the garment industry and used standardized health status measures that Carol Payne was talking about, the short, the SF-36. We actually used a short form of the SF-12 so that we could actually document, and this is the first time it's been documented, of the actual pain and suffering that's going on among those women, essentially, mostly Asian, mostly Chinese Asian, and Latino women that are suffering from carpal tunnel syndrome working in the garment industry. And those, they suffered severe financial hardships and used up their savings, lost their insurance, were no longer able to work. We need to do much better efforts in educating communities of vulnerable workers here in New York City. Of their rights and responsibilities of safety in the workplace. Because this is an aging issue. It happens during your working years, but it progresses into pain and disability as an older person. So we've got this dual challenge, I believe here as well, in increasing productivity among our rapidly aging population. It doesn't have to be market productivity, though jobs are important, and I think there will be a lot of opportunities for jobs. But also non-market productivity. There's a lot of talk in the conferences that I go to. The retirement is no longer kind of the end of productive activity. It's merely a transition in which you can then start something else. Maybe non-market. Maybe it's more social volunteer work. Maybe it's working with children, underprivileged children, and giving them some reading help. There are a ton of ways that I think there's going to be a lot of productive contributions in the years to come. And so this myth of everybody retiring and then flying off to Florida is really a myth. It doesn't happen. It's, and I think New York is going to be a wonderful place age, and we're going to see a lot of new programs and productivity coming out of our aging seniors. So that's one way, positive way to think about it. The other is we need to help family caregivers. We were talking about that earlier. Family caregivers program is another very important area for research of how can we support family caregivers. As you can see, Asian Americans have the highest rates of caring for their family, older family members, of all different, of all the ethnicities compared in this study. Mental health, we talked about that. Mental health is a leading issue, just beginning to be addressed. Developing some research now with Bellevue Hospital and looking at a family systems therapeutic intervention for Asian elders who are depressed and their families. These facts speak for themselves of a 3 times higher suicide rate among elderly Chinese immigrants. These findings and some of their earlier discussion just underscore the urgency for more research on mental health of elderly Chinese immigrants and how can we better build programs that will take into account the complex factors affecting this. Obviously it's cultural issues. Many Chinese do not recognize depression, it's somaticized, there's a thing called neurasthenia as an official diagnosis in China. There are many other contextual factors we need to account for that we may be mixing up with depression too in our depression scales, such as grief experience associated with immigration. Just the joint stress of immigration and aging, which is kind of a double whammy, The stigmatization from mental illness that can sort of compound depression, and again, depressive symptoms are expressed in somatic ways, to be aware. So what are the implications then of all these research threads I've been talking about in brief detail, and trying to weave together a tapestry for you, for training a new health workforce? Well, I certainly agree with our commissioner. That's what he said, and it's the first thing I have as well. And looking for, there's a new report just out yesterday from the National Task Force on the Healthcare Workforce, and predicting workforce needs in the future associated with our aging population. And one of the first things in the largest section on needs is social workers. We need a lot more social workers. As well as geriatricians and nurses and home care workers. And there's going to be a huge demand in the healthcare field for better trained, culturally competent workers. And so to develop new workers, to help those workers in the field develop new skills in cultural competence, there's a huge amount of training. And as you know, Brookdale has a very strong active training program. And we are very eager and involved in this effort. Another area is evidence-based practice and outcomes assessment. This is, social work now is talking about this all the time, but are they doing it? That's the, we need to get to the next step where we're actually doing it. Dr. Carmen Morano, who is our new senior research fellow at the Brookdale Center, is leading an effort on developing training programs and education in outcomes-based, evidence-based practice and social work. And again, these kinds of trainings require, again, multidisciplinary teams and can build partnerships with researchers and put together, as I pointed out earlier, cost-effectiveness analyses that can change policy. But we have to have outcomes first. We have to demonstrate with evidence that our small programs are making a difference. And they could be making a difference in quality of life among the elderly, among the family members caring for the elderly. All those things have economic benefits to the society and can be actually measured and estimated and used in this sort of policy modeling to present cost-effectiveness analyses in the kind of language that policymakers and legislators hear that can then affect actual legislation and program allocations. We're going to face a huge doctor shortage. This was in the New York Times just a couple of years ago. We have only 9,000 currently certified in geriatric medicine right now. We need 20,000. That need is only going to continue. And I did find one book that is recently published on social work practice in an Asian American elderly. And it's actually a very interesting book. And I think the field is beginning. What's the importance of the ivory tower, as we called it? Theory is important. It helps provide a framework from which you can then build these analyses that can be politically effective. But you need to ask different research questions. You need to generate new ideas. I'm a health economist, so I have a bias towards health economics, cost-effectiveness analysis, but there's no single best framework to develop research from. It's multiple perspectives are valuable, and I'd say even very valuable. Building in the social work perspective and the economist perspective, I think, is a very exciting direction to proceed in, and bringing in behavioral sciences and epidemiology. The example of tobacco control, which I've been involved with the Chinese community in Flushing and Sunset Park, is an example where behavioral science and economists have come together along with political activists and created a totally new atmosphere in this country about tobacco. We need to do the same thing in many other areas, including areas affecting aging and risk factors. We need a deeper understanding of of the context and system and programs and outcomes. Methods, again, there's not just best method, a variety of methods are important, and I do quantitative work, but I partner with qualitative researchers. Ethnography is extremely important, in some ways probably the most important, as we have small groups and we need to understand cultural context better, and that also informs all our conceptual models. Evaluation should be done on every single program you put in place, because then it makes it replicable. People can learn from it. It can become a model. It can become a model for the city. It can become a model for the nation. Very important to evaluate. And evaluation should be rigorous. It should be participatory. It should include the community-based participants. There should be multiple methods of evaluation, qualitative and quantitative. It should be multi-level. We should be looking at the family and the individual and the community. And it should be ongoing. It shouldn't just stop once we have our first outcome. Only then will we actually be able to change prevention priorities in this country. It's not just knowledge, obviously, though. This partnership in building research and service partnerships to build better models and outcomes research in this field will help. It will definitely inform prevention priorities. We will inform Congress to develop perhaps better programs funded by Medicare that actually include, you know, community-based long-term care programs. But we can't do it without each of these other factors. We need a social strategy, we work together with the activists, and we need the political will. There has to be the political will to listen to evidence-based medicine. Not where we are at the moment, but hopefully in the next few years in the U.S. we'll have an administration that actually listens to evidence. So I believe very strongly in sustainability through policy change and that research can contribute to that. And I just want to end my talk and thank you very much for your kind attention that I think we can all gain and benefit so much from the active involvement of ourselves with our seniors, and as we become seniors, our continued active engagement in the community. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Marianne. It gave us a wonderful presentation today. The next is I would like to, I have the privilege of introducing to you our panelists to talk about the training and research on the service to the Asian American elderly. David Chen, he's the executive director, Chinese American Planning Council.
Well, I got two quick comments. First of all, wow, what after that presentation, I got nothing to say. diddle, I better shut up and go home. It was so powerful, really touching all the issues that I had also on my three sheet of notes that I woke up this morning. I didn't prepare for this. I said, I better be prepared for that. I have no abstract. What am I going to talk about? Then 6 o'clock in the morning, I started talking to the computer and see what I was going to say. Many points that she mentioned the same thing I had. But of course, this is much focus and thought process. I necessarily, as a provider, tend to be more eclectic, so I flow all over the place. And I was writing a lot of notes on it as she talked and improvised on it. This is the way we survived in the field. We try to improvise on the theories. Actually, my partner, panelist, is not here, but I was so happy and heartening and indeed actually awakening that Peter Fong was my fellow panelist, I thought. Because Peter and I, 25 years ago, when I used to run a youth program in Chinatown, and Peter used to write a lot about gang problems in Chinatown. So he used to come to me and talk about the deficit model about how youth services are in the city. So surprised that 25 years later, when we put on our reading glasses, we talk about elderly. We also talk about research, looking at the future. Obviously, we realize that the future is indeed talk about successors and people looking into further the future and think about the ways we talked about 25 years ago. Men did the same thing. A lot of things didn't change. A lot of things changed. A lot of things still didn't change. And I guess what didn't change is really we still had an information deficit model. we don't have enough data. Right? Political will is important, right? That's another thing we share. Because of lack of political will, whatever, because of political will, we're still here talking about it. And we really don't have enough data. And time has changed in many ways. As we move on, right? Time has changed in many ways that the information is no longer broad stroke. From the Asian American community, for the longest time, we have always been focused on, yeah, we know there's no data, but we focus on needs, always focus on needs. But as Professor said, need is not the only thing now. You gotta talk about outcome measures. What about impact? How do you measure impact? If you don't have a planning in the beginning, how do you measure impact? You had the question in the beginning. So research and planning become so important that, well, being not a researcher, but I learned to be a researcher and advocate something in common, and that is to keep on asking questions. I don't know how to solve them because I'm a practitioner, but I keep on asking questions that I want to change. Because I think that's the part that I can contribute from a provider perspective to the research angles. We ask the same question, but I say, why not? How come things are not done yet? So you better tell me a reason why it can be done. So I think that is the marriage part that at a lot of time, the practice and theory can come together, you know. Information deficit is like Professor mentioned, like access. A lot of times it's not only research in terms of research data, it's really on the other hand, it's the users. How are we providers in the field utilize those data to use it to enhance our ability to do things and also our ability to write proposals that address evidence-based or knowledge-based funding. Nowadays, if you don't do evidence-based, knowledge-based funding, you can't measure it, you don't get granted. Because 20, 30 years ago, when we write proposal, we advocate for the need, educate them about model minority, educate about the bimodal nature of our problem. We gotta explain 10 pages before we tell what we're gonna do, because you always have to dispel that myth. Nowadays, sometimes I tell you one thing that happened, I find out that all these myths are no longer dispelled in the RFP. They already have 3 pages talking about the needs I advocated before. Because they hired many of us among the ranks of RFP. They hired many Asian Americans, become policymakers too. So they indeed put an RFP that already exposed the issue that we addressed before. The question is, you can't copy RFP. You gotta develop specific models to address what they want you to do. It's no longer talking. You really have to adjust specificity, how you implement those ideas. You still have to advocate, you still have to fill out a scope yet. But many times it's no longer that. You really look at specificity, how do you address those things? When you address those things, then you can't talk about the same thing that everybody else did. Why you? Why you? And that's the issue about the cost effectiveness come in. Because we all know social workers have talked about effectiveness, I mean program effectiveness for a long time. But nowadays, the management model, I guess we have Republican mayor, Republican governor, Republican president, Republican administration. So the model is one of cost efficiency, cost effectiveness too, you know, not only efficiency. Our model is always program effectiveness. But the darn thing is, pardon my language, the darn thing is we don't know how to measure them. We keep on talking about effectiveness, we keep on advocating, but when they come up with cost effectiveness, unit cost, ours tend out to be more expensive than others. And cannot explain why we're so expensive, just like serving senior. But what I heard earlier, comment on too, when we talk about senior, our paradigm really have to change. Not only senior, social service in general. Paradigm have to look at the investment model the Republicans want. Their thinking is, senior citizen, why are senior citizens 55 over less able than before? When indeed senior citizens, elderly, are differently able people. They may not be physically competent in many ways than the younger, but they are brain mentally smarter than many of the young people, are more reliable, more dependable. Well, why don't we emphasize on that as an investment model to build models? Remember now, the current mindset is always, the trend is always building models. So we gotta talk about building on models. We are, the paradigm for providers always look at the deficit model, but somehow we didn't address the resilience factor. We are so good in talking about risk factors, but somehow we forgot about identifying the resilient factors. Why are we so resilient, Asian elderly, Asian community? To overcome that a situation could have been worse if we didn't face this adversity. You have to identify adversity, of course, but yet the answer is a solution to come up with a model that positive thinking, positive aging, can lead to as an effective way to reduce costs. Because in that sense, that's the cost effectiveness that come in. If we can incorporate that in the research model, no longer just the risk factor, but indeed the resilience factor. In that sense, we are a lot of things to share to let the other population learn to prevent this kind of thing from the population that goes down. I think we have plenty of things to tell. I think they probably will invest in us. I think that is a model, a paradigm that I think we really have to shift from researchers' perspective. And one word about cultural competence. I was involved with SAMHSA, the Substance Mental Health Administration, on some cultural competence and framework development. I mean, you know, a lot of times it's interesting. You always talk about framework development. You know, a lot of framework, I don't see much action. You know, a lot of framework, you know. But you know why? Because they really don't know what the details are. I was involved with some framework development community partnership about cultural competence back in the mid to late 80s. And how many of you have not heard the word cultural competence? Everybody has, right? How many of you are providers? How many of you are theories, researchers? But guess what? I was called back last summer because my name was still with the Culture Development Framework mailing list somehow. So they called me back and formed a focus group and try to find out what the hell is cultural competence. They acknowledge these are SAMHSA PhD, whatever researchers in there. They acknowledge, they said, 15 years ago, we understand the diversity, demographic. Remember, they read the demographics a lot earlier than we do. The feds know that it's coming. Or was it year 2020, 35 or something? Majority census will reverse. They know it's coming. They know diversity. How do you deal with it? Cultural competence. So they incorporate cultural competence as a criteria to give 10 points more if you put cultural competence in your proposal. Right? Absolutely, right? If you forgot to put it in there, you got 5 or 10 points less. So they said, this is, again, the people who rated the proposal. They said, every time you mention cultural competence, the criteria say, add 5 points, 10 points. So they did. Said, 15 years later, now the new paradigm about outcome measures, right? Congress, accountability thing involved. So they asked, what is cultural competence? They said, we don't know. We've been doing it for 15 years. But what is cultural competence? So they called back the original people, right? And this is very mixed group, especially really, you know, Native American, Hispanic, Asian. Well, not that many. Asians come back the same old people you know all the time. And we asked the same question. What is our cultural competence? So you go back the same old story, telling the things we told all the time. How we do it. But then they're starting to do it. This is a year and a half. I just called back in January again. They have some framework developed again. Issued the paper, they said they will come up by fall, I think, 2 years later. But the good news is they are really still working on it. Right? But then they really changed the fact that they need to look at specificity. How do you measure it? Don't just talk. Right? So imagine that they are looking at the criteria, and now it really in terms of how we evaluate, it's important for us to really understand what cultural competence means. And then cultural competence tend to be looked upon as a practitioner angle. How do you deliver cultural competence services? We always thought it was a language. It's not one language. Cultural competence is not just ethnic culture. It's a lot of subculture. Aging, younger, gender, you know, all these things. All these are differences. How do you deal with it? So I guess cultural competence is not among practitioner only, but really cultural competence starts with the researchers. If you ask the right question, if you want to address the issue, especially relating the ground up and understanding the differences, the instrument that you develop, the tools that you develop will be harder to use or difficult to use by the users. So I think it goes back to the whole thing about planning, research, evaluation, right, assessment, everything else, it goes into a cycle. I happen to spend my prior life on a few years in evaluation. So I know a little bit about process evaluation, outcome evaluation. It has been there all the time in the science of the evaluation, process and outcome. But somehow we're still talking about efficiency, cost effectiveness. These are social work school taught you all that too. But now you know it is increasing the details are, the devil's in the details. So how do we translate our research, translate our practitioner really in a cultural competent way, but also from Asian American perspective, how do we turn around, use it less of the it is information deficit. But how do you from the deficit model and turn the mindset into an investment model so we can get some bucks into the research? I always say that it's wonderful we have conferences like this to bring people together and we talk about the issue, we really see wonderful stuff, you know, we re-energize the same old thing that we had. But always regret to say that between conferences, there are not enough resources to get it done. So I guess in that sense, I'm still here talking. So after 25 years, I'm still talking, right? So like I said, it's the same issue we dealt with for young people. It's the same people we deal with older people. We all now acknowledge that it takes a village to raise a child. Well, let me say that when I put in my reading glasses, it takes a village to help elderly also. So I guess in that sense, it is not the theory of practice. It really, really a very comprehensive issue we deal with in terms of providing effective service to the community. Thank you very much. I guess I take longer than I said. You see a lot of the thank you.
Thank you, David Chen, for this excellent idea. So I open the floor to questions. Any questions? Yes. Yes.
David, could you explain a little more this issue about going with widows in the Asian community and why?
Could you, David, could you please explain a little bit more your concept of political will and what's happening to the Asian community in terms of services, particularly for Asian elderly, and why there is, at this point, appears to be under support from local governments?
Well, I think political will means hang in there. Hang in there. You know, a lot of times in today's situation, so many trends that go on, sound bites, all these things, policy change. Why is America the richest country and yet the most neglect in dealing with poverty in a consistent way? We talk about every few years, but sometimes an issue cancels each other. So what happened before, you know, and move on to a different trend. Today is teen pregnancy, tomorrow is elderly, tomorrow is housing, homelessness, whatever. But somehow you miss out the comprehensive nature with tied it together. It is cultural conflict. It is poverty. When you deal with those issues, then you start to see the political will of lasting more than the trend. So you have to hang in there. Political will means you just don't follow the come and go of issues, but you have to see it in a sustaining way. It's not just, well, I guess Peter's not here, otherwise the two of us would really have a party and talk about how sometimes you really can talk, you can talk senior in the same stroke, because after you put up the reading class. Yeah. But it's very true. Political will means sustaining. Hang in there, keep trying. Don't give up that easily.
Yes, Professor, I'm very impressed by your inclusive and very broad and expanding the conceptual of the senior health, aging, and especially I wonder you have such master knowledge of senior, and whether you have used the power of knowledge transferring to political lobbying. I wonder. Number one, number two. Could you assess the ARP, their impact on the whole aging field? And number three, I wonder, since David, CDC director has been non-field in this ARP, how both of your agency can work together to form kind of a lobby work and research and planning and implementation? Thank you.
Thank you for your broad question. to address the first one of combining knowledge with political advocacy, this actually gets back to, I think, the first question as well as political will. I love David's answer of sustainability. We have to realize now, however, that federal funds are really very, very important at the local level. And when the federal political will is not there, it really does affect us. And it's not necessarily a lack of political will at the local level. I have to remember that. I think it's very important to use collaborations between research and service, and both at the local and particularly at the federal level. And I guess the example I gave, which is it's a real example. I mean, I really did work with service providers to develop this analysis that was then presented to Congress. Now, and then did lead to the first passage of the first preventive benefit for Medicare. But before I become too starry-eyed about that, it did not hurt at all that the cytology labs were also in favor of this. I mean, there was a for-profit industry, the lab industry, that would gain quite a bit from a whole new flood of population that would need to pass smear screens and lab testers. So public-private partnerships, you know, politics makes strange bedfellows. And I think we need to be opportunistic with our concerns when they're going to be, and find partnerships with perhaps a pharmaceutical company. I mean, we don't necessarily have to think of them as advocates of political, political left, who may think of the pharmaceutical industry as the enemy. And yet they may be a good advocate for some parts of a program. So I think it's an openness to partnerships, finding good people, not letting industries or define, not stereotyping, just staying open and working with good partnerships. And then I think it's sustainability. It's just working together. The energy motivates itself when you find good partnerships that you can stimulate energy just among the people and have wonderful parties and actually get good work done. So I really look forward to in the future. I would urge all of us to get out and campaign like crazy the next elections, both the interim and then the presidential, so that we will have a change in political will and how, so that then our partnerships can then, I think, have more marginal difference. And I really look forward very much to working at Brookdale, particularly in developing programs that would do that, to bridge policy and service in ways that are effective in creating new legislation and opportunities. And what was your third issue?
Just a few words about AARP.
Oh, AARP, I'm sorry. Yes, right, thank you. AARP, I don't think has focused enough on diversity yet. I would like to see it focus more. I think it's been a very mainstream organization. There is a new research director there that used to be the head of Brookdale. Hal Moody is his name. And I think he's putting out some very interesting work, some good work. But I think there are untapped opportunities to urge AARP to get more involved in reducing disparities in aging. They're beginning to focus on it, and I think they can be urged further. And I think we could build good partnerships would be a good thing. It's obviously a very large and powerful organization to partner with.
I have a question. Do I have the microphone? I thought perhaps Professor Foss could tell us a little bit more about the training programs that you are doing. You mentioned the need for more social workers, more nurses, more gerontologists, and so forth. What is the Brookdale Center doing to provide an incentive for our students? After all, City University is a training institution and an educating institution. So what are they doing to increase the number of social workers, nurses, and gerontologists, so forth, that will be needed in the future?
Well, thank you for this opportunity to advertise a little bit what we're doing. One important initiative I think is under development right now with the Hartford Foundation that Carmen Morano is building is aging and health in the social work program at Hunter, and using that as a model for a national program and working with the Hartford Foundation to create a national leadership program in aging and health among other social work schools. We're trying to gerontologize the curriculum really across CUNY. there are a number of different task forces that are being developed to develop better curriculum, to have aging actually be part of the curriculum in many different areas, political science, sociology, not just specific aging courses. And that being said, we are developing specific aging courses as well within the curriculum. And aging and health is an undergraduate course we've offered, as well as developing graduate level courses. So we reach out as well to undergraduate students and have a fair once a year on careers in aging and try to create an exciting kind of panorama of opportunities in aging as a growing and important field. I see some of my fellow professors here, particularly, would you like to comment on
Well, we did get the scholarship money from the Hartman Institute for, we have a small first grant we got for supporting graduate education for nurses and gerontological nurse practitioner program. That had enough for 6 people this year, and hopefully we can apply for more of that. We're still trying to fill these slots because that is not a field that general nurses go into as much as we know they need, because most nurses will be working with the older adult. But we do have to attract them with some incentives, and you're right about that.
Okay, since we are running time, let's continue our conversation during our break. And finally, we would like to thank our presenters, Maria Fett, and also the David Chen. Thank you so much.